in a British school system is a very good way of thickening one's skin. But even with that training, I was kind of taken aback when, some years ago now in Hyderabad, I was accused of being a neo-imperialist using green fascism to subdue the Indian nation. And the reason that the context of the conversation was that I was talking about rice, and I was talking about rice and greenhouse gas emissions, and I was making the point that rice has got significantly higher greenhouse gas emissions per kilogram of crop than any of the other major cereals. And it wasn't so much that I was wrong, I don't think, but the fact that I had just entirely misunderstood what rice was. That rice wasn't just a source of nutrition, rice was a source of food, and as such, you know, it had cultural elements, it had habits associated with it, religious issues associated with it. So it was a much more than just a source of nutrition. And this was a very kind of good, sharp kind of lesson for me to look at the sustainability of issues from a much broader perspective. And so, you know, rice is, even just from the straightforward environmental sustainability, rice is much more than just greenhouse gas emissions. You need water, you need inputs, you need labour, you need gender, you need pests, you need diseases, you need biodiversity to grow your rice. And so what I'm really wanting to talk about today is this idea of rice and sustainability, but from a much broader perspective. And how can we begin to answer this slightly ridiculous question I put up, you know, is rice sustainable? And so first of all, I'm going to do that through, and then I'm really wanting to open up about where this leads us. And this last bit is really where I'm wanting more input from you, because I'm going way beyond my comfort zone on this last part of the conversation. So rice, okay, so first of all with India. So India, the kind of thing you have to know about India is that essentially a lot of India is incredibly old soil. So kind of people are arguing a bit, but 40, 50 million years ago, India came up from further down in the southern hemisphere and then came up and whacked into Asia. And as it did that, it caused the Himalayas. So it caused the highest mountain range in the world, from oceanic plates. So you've got the lovely irony that the highest mountain in the world is made out of the bottom of the ocean floor. But the fact it's incredibly old is important because generally old soils are highly weathered. Most of the kind of good bits have been taken out of it. And so much of the soil in India is fairly low quality. The exception is everything which is irrigated or from the Himalayas. So we've got the enormous alluvial soils that really take up a large chunk of the North India, where it's come down from the north, and we've got relatively new soils. And this area, about 13% of India, producing about 40% of the food. But if we go further south, then there are still exceptions, but generally the soil is fairly old, fairly weathered, not much inherent fertility to it. The other side about India is it's incredibly densely populated, so it's much more densely populated, for example, than the UK, even though it's got large swathes of fairly unproductive area in terms of deserts or mountains. It's a cliche to say that India is two nations, and it's a very simplistic way of putting it, but there is a truth that if you look at Forbes' list, then the third largest number of billionaires, dollar billionaires in any country is in India, and give or take the third of the world poor is in India. So it's this country of multiple different parts, with, especially where I've been studying in the south, inherently unfertile soils. And that's so tiny bit of context. Another critical fact to make about India is talking about its informal economy. So the idea of the informal economy is the informal economy is anything outside the direct reach of the state. And it's not necessarily black money, it's just money it's monies and institutions where the state doesn't engage. And so this becomes incredibly important in things like health and safety, minimum wage, any of these factors, let alone what products you're going to put on your farm, whether you're going to follow any environmental regulation or not. So the informal economy dominates much of India. So the figures are highly spurious, but give or take 90% of India's economy, give or take 90% of India's workforce is informal, and about two-thirds of the economy. And the other side of that factor is that India's economic growth, so India's now claiming to have the largest growth in the world, and whether or not we believe those figures, India's economic growth is dominated by the high-tech sector. So unlike any other country in the world where the growth has come from large number of people doing essentially industrial jobs, whether we're looking at the West, whether we're looking at China, whether we're looking at Taiwan, in India the growth is dominated by a small number of highly educated people doing work in IT sectors, for example. And this means that the main growth in India isn't associated with the majority of the people. So the reason all these comes in is this thing I was talking about at the beginning about how we can't just look at rice from the single narrow perspective of the, whether it's greenhouse gas or wider food security or environmental factors. We have to engage with the wider area. And the last thing to say about the informal economy is that it's ignored from climate talks. It tends to be ignored from wider international policy discussions, largely because it's very hard for people to do anything about. Even though it dominates the economy, it dominates the workforce, it tends to be ignored. Then we have rice. So rice, it feeds more people than any other crop in the world. And it's interesting in how it's produced. It's produced predominantly in by small farmers around the world. The origin of rice is still heavily disputed. Different people claim it for their country. Most people seem to suggest it was domesticated probably about 6,000 to 9,000 years ago in China. There's also, this is the kind of typical rice, Oryza sativa, which is the common rice. There's also another one from that's indigenous to Africa. And one of the key things to know about rice is that it was an aquatic plant. And so we tend to grow rice in paddy system underwater. And it's not that it needs to grow in water. The fact more is that it can grow in water. And so the reason that we tend to grow it in water is largely as a weed control measure. So while rice can grow in water, most other weeds can't. And so it's a very effective way of controlling other weeds. So if we look at pesticide use globally, for example, or if we look at issues reducing yield globally, it's not pests, it's not diseases, it's weeds is the main competition. So that's why we tend to grow rice in flooded conditions. You can have dryland rice, but rice, because it's aquatic background, tends to be fairly sensitive to being thoroughly dried out. But the factors grown underwater often dominates the greenhouse gas emissions associated with rice. Later on, I'm going to talk a little bit about the nutritional side of rice and where that comes in as well. But for now, I'm going to want to focus on the environment. So what I'm going to do now is I want to just focus on one aspect of work that I did in the project. And this is to do with a thing called system of rice intensification. Has anyone not heard of SRI? Okay, so a couple of you haven't. And so system of rice intensification is essentially, it's a loose term, it's a fairly unhelpful term, I think. But it's got a few key parts to it. It's transplanting rice at an earlier stage. It's having intermittently flooded irrigation. It's having large amounts of manure, and it's having wider spacing. So often if you talk to farmers, they'll say they're doing SRI when they might just be doing one or two parts of this. But this is the kind of overarching aspect. And the figures for SRI, I didn't really believe to start with. So the figures you get in the web, people treat SRI like a superfood to the extent that people either love it or hate it. And there's an enormous amount of people who really claim that SRI is the solution to everything. And I automatically got suspicious at that point, but a lot of our work showed that it was surprisingly effective. The more muck aspect is incredibly important, again, when we come to greenhouse gas emissions specifically. So the background to this story was we wanted to work out how we can look at the sustainability of anything. We chose to look at rice, but it could have been roads, it could have been cement. We wanted to look at sustainability looking at within the context of the informal economy and within the context of different disciplines coming together. So this is a key group of us that came together to do a large project, so ESRC and DFID funded project in India looking at rice. And we've got an economist, we've got Hema from Madras School of Economics, Barbara Harris-White, who's a field economist again, a social scientist. One of the most interesting people was Gautam Reddy. So he's the leader of the largest trade union in India, the New Trade Union Initiative. And there's amazing work from someone like me who's come from a very reductionist scientific background to work with the trade unionists was a total revolution to how I saw and thought things. And then social scientists and an anthropologist. And so we were going to look at rice, and it's a lovely story bringing different people together. But the reality is often quite difficult. We all had different areas we wanted to look at. And one thing we didn't want to do is have what I'm going to call a black bean project. So multidisciplinary projects are talked about a lot. But I'm going to suggest that the typical multidisciplinary project is you get your black bean, and you have your climate person looking at it from his angle, and your economist looking at it, and your social scientist looking at it, and your gender expert looking at it, and your nutritionist looking at it. And we meet at the beginning, and we all do our work, and then we all write separate chapters in the book, and we publish the book, and we call it multidisciplinary work. But the reality is we never particularly talk to each other, we never particularly engage, and we never force our disciplines to work together. And one key thing we wanted to do here was to get over that problem. And so my area was to really be the linchpin between it all. So what we did was we did a modelling exercise. And the advantage of modelling is that it forces you to come up with numbers. The disadvantage of modelling is identical, that it forces you to use numbers, and there's a lot of areas that shouldn't really be using numbers. But the overall structure of the project was this. It was a complicated slide, but what we wanted to do was to look at rice in its entirety. So if we just look at the middle bit, we looked at different farming systems, we looked at transport, we looked at milling, again transport, and then different types of retail systems. So we wanted to understand rice in South India, how it goes through the entire production system. The reason to have the entire production system is there's not much benefit in focusing. If we focused on transport and we found a way of reducing the greenhouse gas emissions from transport by 20%, well, transport only is a few percent of the entire greenhouse gas emissions, so it was a waste of effort. So the reason to look at the entire food chain is that then you can see where, which parts dominate which sectors. We didn't look at everything. We couldn't look at everything, but these are things we looked at. So the green are crudely the environmental factors, the red crudely the social, and the blue crudely the economic. And then because we were modelling, we could bring in assumptions. So what would happen if we charged family labour? So on all the rice farms, all farms in India and in much of the world, a lot of the work is done by family labour. And if you talk to the farmer about the costs of the system, they'll ignore the costs of their time because they never saw it as an economic transaction. But the reality is that there is a cost, and there's an opportunity cost. Maybe they could have worked elsewhere. So by modelling, we could say, we could just press a simple button, and we could say, how did the economics change if you included family labour within the calculations? Similarly, electricity there was free. What happens if we charge for electricity? So this is, you know, wonderfully simplistic policy assumptions going in, but incredibly important as well. So electricity is free to all farmers in southern India. And this means that they have little incentive to use it in a rational way. And the main use of electricity is pumping water from deep boreholes. So it came in for political systems. The massive subsidy to electricity is unlikely to go out for the same political systems. But at least for the first time, we can show how it might change people's behaviour if electricity was charged. We were trying to look at the whole system. We were trying to look at a lot of different factors. And we're trying to bring them all together into a single model. So I want you to be impressed by this slide for our ambition and to be understanding for some of the results that we got. One key issue, so talking to different people, was this issue of the normative values of life. So the one I liked the most is labour good or bad? So we had two key people on this discussion on our research group. One was a trade unionist and one was someone from the NGO sector. Trade union wanted to get rid of labour on farms. So they said, you know, they wanted to use mechanisation to get rid of what they call drudgery. And it's not just physical drudgery, but also within the village system in India, the caste system is still in existence at different levels of power. But essentially you have landless labour who are having to work for more powerful, structurally powerful landowners. And so there's a lot of complicated factors there within the social side. The NGO said, you know, their word for, you know, labour is honest, you know, it's needed, and so they saw tractors as bad. And so we've got this wonderful thing of pure normative things. Is labour good or bad? If we've got one rice production system which takes 6 minutes to produce a kilogram of rice on a field, compared to another one which takes 39 minutes, you know, which is better, which is worse? And because we're modelling, we didn't have to have this as a kind of fundamental normative factor. But it was a really interesting discussion that goes on, even this was a relatively small part of our whole area. And I'm going to come later to how we can kind of address sustainability as a whole. But one of my points I want to make is that we have to talk to people we're not used to talking to. And this caused a lot of very bad feeling within our group. Just this thing, the people really didn't want to carry on engaging people which took such opposing views on this one issue. And they both took it from a very emotional perspective. So I found just this one factor to be a wonderful kind of window into the problems of trying to look at sustainability from different disciplines. So, yeah, this bottom bit, if you don't give something a value, it has no value. So this is the kind of cliche of modern economic approaches to environmental sustainability. But the other side is if you try and quantify the unquantifiable, you get rubbish. So it's a kind of issue of rubbish in, rubbish out. And This is where we got stuck on issues like labour, issues like landscape, issues like beauty. You know, how if you don't quantify them, are they just ignored and they never go in? If you do quantify them, is it just entirely rubbish that you're getting out? I'm not going to pretend to even answer that question, but it'd be lovely to talk about it later. So very simple answers, just looking at SRI, because SRI in a way is the most exciting of the rice production systems we looked at. For interest, the other ones we looked at were conventional green revolution techniques, rain-fed rice, so this is where you haven't got access to irrigation, much higher labour inputs, much lower yields, much lower agrochemical inputs, and organic rice. But SRI, I mentioned before, they kind of talked, the literature is very excited about SRI, and the figures were quite amazing. So if we look at yield per hectare, then it goes up by over 60%. Greenhouse gas emissions are the same per hectare, but obviously far lower per kilogram because we've got this increase in yield. And the groundwater is considerably less per hectare. I mean, I don't know, did anyone want to give me a figure for how much water in tons or kilograms they think would be used for 1 kilogram of rice? Pick a number, any number, and I'll laugh if you get it wrong.
100 litres.
100 litres. Any increase in 100 litres?
1,000.
1,000? Oh, it's getting expensive here.
2 tons.
2 tons. So the figures we got, so it ranged, rain-fed rice had no groundwater. So we were only measuring groundwater. So rain-fed rice obviously had zero on that level. But in terms of just looking at groundwater, we had between 3 and 5 tons of water per kilogram of rice. You know, this is an incredible large amount of water. Some of that water might have been recycled because we were looking at what was pumped up. So some of it might have gone down through the soil and been pumped up again. But the pumping itself is an incredibly important source of energy use and also greenhouse gas emissions, largely because the pumping is from electricity and India's electricity system is dominated by coal. So this is, you know, a ton of water obviously is a cubic meter. So we might be using 3 to 5 cubic meters of water for our single kilogram of rice. And that's before we've even cooked it when we take it home. So being able to reduce water by this much per hectare, remember, is a lot. Kilogram you can semi-translate from the change to change in yield. The thing that's interesting is if you look at profit per hectare, so profit was massively increased. It's not that surprising. Your yield's gone up enormously without much increase in, well, your costs, you can see, they weren't particularly significant, but your costs were effectively the same while your yield goes up enormously. So your marginal cost is much lower. The other interesting factor is total labour went down a bit and total employed hours went down more, but the critical thing was total female labour went down a lot. So the reason that the labour went down here is because the weeding was mechanised. So when you can mechanise weeding, two factors happened. Because it was mechanised, it could be done at a faster rate, but also it became a male job. And the fact of the shifting to females, sorry, the loss of female labour, so a large generalisation, but depressingly holds, is that if you look at the amount of money that goes into a family from male labour versus female labour, you tend to get more spent on the overall household from a woman's earnings than a male's earnings in southern India. So we can suggest that there's an increased loss of household income as we shift the gender that are doing the work. Does that make sense? So this is why the gender matters. The actual total money that was spent per hectare, so the total amount of remuneration per hectare was actually not much different between the two systems, because as we had more male labour, and males tend to be paid more, then the overall community didn't really lose out, but the females lost out specifically. So, I'm being incredibly kind of quick on all these things, because I really want to have time later, but as a kind of very broad thing, we can say SRI is good for water, energy, yield, greenhouse gas, profit, and labour efficiency, and bad for overall employment, and especially female employment. What are we supposed to make from that? What are we supposed to say to that? You know, how do we move forward from this kind of results? So that's a question I'm going to leave hanging, partly because I simply don't know the answer. But what I really want to do now is to move on to an area which is much more, kind of much further beyond my level of expertise. And I want to move on to talking about how we should deal with these kind of issues. So when we talk about is rice sustainable, whether it's rice, whether it's roads, whether it's different forms of transport, you know, how should we even begin to ask these questions? But before I want to do that, You know, I put the word success there in question mark. So, you know, this project was, it was an academic, it was totally successful. You know, we ticked lots of boxes. We fused together different disciplines, such as value chain analysis, life cycle assessment, labourer studies, into a single model, which hasn't been done before. So we published, we went to enormous amounts of talks, had lots of papers, it was very exciting. But the real thing we were trying to do was to trying to understand, you know, the sustainability of rice. And I don't think we really got very far there. I mean, one of the really obvious things we did is we didn't ask if rice is sustainable. What we were really doing is comparing different rice production systems. And so we can say on this metric, you know, SRI is better, and on this metric, organic is better. But maybe we shouldn't be eating rice at all, or you know, maybe the fundamental question was wrong. So these are the kind of issues we didn't manage to ask. So this is kind of, you know, what matters and what's missed out. So this is the kind of slide that you can put up at any level, I feel. So you can put it up to kind of to school children, to undergraduates, or I don't know where the highest level would be, so to very wise people. This is me kind of bearing my soul. So what is sustainability? And one person defines sustainability as a Trojan horse. So within this word sustainability, we can all put in whatever method, whatever word we like. And this is very dangerous, because if we do that, then all of us sitting around a table can agree that sustainability advice is very important, and we can all go away happy that we've agreed with each other, but yet we've all got entirely different definitions of what sustainability is. So sustainability is an inherently fuzzy word, you know, and within it there's often trade-offs that we don't necessarily appreciate. But yet, we all have an idea of what sustainability is as well, so I don't want to kind of throw out the word. So what I want to just talk now is, one thing we didn't do is do this kind of this much bottom-up approach within our project. So words like, you know, participatory rural appraisal or farmer-led. And these words aren't ones that I'm familiar with. So these words are ones, you know, I've come along, I've spent my life in a lab, and I want to go along and I don't want to talk to people, I want to look at, you know, I want to look at the nature. So these are kind of difficult words for me, but I'm also a little bit suspicious of some of them. So I sometimes feel when we talk about participatory work or farmer-led work, we're very happy to participate and to be led when we want to participate in that area and when we want to be led in that direction. So if I was looking at biodiversity, which I happen to be interested in, I'm very happy to work with farmers who want to increase their biodiversity. I'm very happy to take a farmer-led approach there, but I'm much less happy to take a farmer-led approach when they simply don't give a damn about it and they simply want to get the highest short-term reproduction and economic output from their farm. So these are very obvious concepts, but for people from a purely reductionist science perspective, this is the kind of approach that we have. So a key part of rice, obviously, is eating. So I said at the beginning, it's not just about eating, but a key part of it is eating. And the 1996 definition for food security, it includes dietary needs and food preferences within it. And this is quite amazing. I mean, this is over 20 years ago, and people talked about the idea of food preferences, as well as just nutrition, as well as just production. And so kind of good for them. But food preferences are quite interesting. So going back to right at the beginning of the talk, when I was labelled this neo-colonialist for using green fascism to subdue the Indian nation, this was from a South Indian man. And in South India, you eat rice for breakfast and in the middle of the day and at the end of the day. And now in kind of 21st South India, you might get chapati and roti, but typically they're used to eat your rice. I mean, it's, you know, it's rice, rice, and rice. So if we ask this fellow about you know, his food preferences, well, it's going to be rice and rice and rice. What should we do with that? What should someone like me do? How do we work with that in terms of sustainability? So this is a key part of what he perceives as his cultural right and his cultural norm. But if we look at rice, then in South India it was actually a fairly minor crop until fairly recently. So a nice quote from, this is actually from a British missionary, I'm afraid, but he was talking about rice. He said his preferred food are the rich, the dainty, and the luxurious. And if we look at how, where rice was produced, rice was always eaten by the higher castes. And it was always eaten on specific religious holidays. But the reality is, the majority of people ate millets, things like ragi. We couldn't produce rice we could only produce rice in the wet season. And it wasn't until the 19th century that rice became kind of a major food crop in South India for day-in, day-out consumption. So in about the 1870s, we got mechanised rice hullers, and they did the other thing of taking off the pericarp, the what's the ovary from the original flour, if this is the brown bit on brown rice. So they made white polished rice. And the mechanisation of it allowed small farmers, small mechanisation units to be able to get rid of the husk, so immediately taking about a third of the bulk off the rice so it can be transported far further. It became a political economy issue, where other areas of the British Empire started sending rice into India at massive levels. And it became a status issue as well. So especially within urban India, people started going for white rice. So people like, all castes within urban India, but the people that suffered, they got beriberi, so where you don't get vitamin B1. You know, you can die from beriberi, it's a terrible condition. And the people that suffered were the poor urban, so the policemen, the people working in factories, the people who went for the white rice but couldn't afford the wider dietary diversity associated with more wealthy people. So my point about this though is, this fellow sees, the fellow who criticised me, he saw rice as his right. He saw rice as this is what makes me an Indian. But yet, you don't go back very far, and rice was there for high days and holidays, and that was it. So that's kind of one of my points I want to make, is how do you bring these kind of subjective things? It's discussions between groups. So we all talk about the need for multidisciplinarity. And when I say normative modelling, I spent my the first 35 years of my life without ever using the word normative. It just didn't come into my kind of world. And if you go onto Web of Science, I don't know how many of you Web of Science is kind of the classic science search engine. If you look at any key ecological values, like biodiversity or ecology or agriculture, then, I just did this last night to check, you'll get hundreds of thousands or millions of hits. If you add in the word normative for those three words, you come down to less than 0.02% every time. They're just, something like agriculture, which just, in case anyone else isn't familiar with the word normative like I wasn't, normative is the kind of should thing. It's what should we be looking at. And it's just not discussed. These two words don't come together. And then the other side is modelling. So I find with a lot of people who work in outside the sciences, the word model is a scary word, and it tends to mean something very clever, which often associated with the climate. The reality is, of course, modelling is simply a conceptual framework for putting an idea. So the normative modelling problem is really this issue of different disciplines not knowing how to talk to each other. And that's if we assume they want to talk to each other in the first place. So we all know this, but the reality is that maybe it's different in CAWR, but where I'm based, there's a lot of scientists who feel they're devalued as scientists if they start going too far outside their field. And by their field, they don't just mean a chemist talking to a biologist. They mean a specific branch within chemistry. And I know I'm telling you things that we already know, but this is, we know it maybe so much that we ignore it. This is a really, really fundamental problem. And then it gets worse because we will talk to other academics to an extent, but how many people will talk to different sectors in society? So Barbara and I were at the Oxford Real Farming Conference, and possibly wrongly, but we had a meeting with Nestle on board, and people got incredibly upset because Nestle was there. And Nestle, if you're my generation, Nestle were brought up as, Nestle and Thatcher were the two devils. These were the people you hissed and spat at. But the reality is that Nestle dominates a large section of the food market. That if we don't talk to Nestle, if we don't like Nestle, we can destroy Nestle. But if we're not going to destroy Nestle, we've got to engage with Nestle, because Nestle is much of the food market of the world. I mean, Maggi noodles is a staple diet in much of India at the moment, just being taken off because it's got too much lead in it. But this is what people are eating. This is now. And so this is where I think it's incredibly important for what I'm calling real discussion. So if we want to look at, is rice sustainable, or is anything sustainable, there's really two things I'm trying to say. So one is, how do we even begin to address the question? And the second is, who do we bring in on the discussions? So when we bring to address the, when we try and address the question, we can go the kind of route that we did, which is the modelling, the reductionist approach, which gives you lots of interesting answers, but doesn't necessarily solve the problem. But then who do you talk to? And this is an even harder nut to crack. And I think that all of us are guilty of having our assumptions and our prejudices. And I'm not saying that we have to get into bed with everyone, but I am saying we either have to destroy them or engage with them, whatever the people are. So this is a really naff rehash of a quote, but I think it's really good. So Keynes had a quote saying, the market can stay irrational longer than you can stay solvent. And the food system at the moment within India, whether we're just looking at rice and the fact that everyone's eating highly polished white rice, which is nutritionally pretty bereft, or we're looking at the global food system, the global food system, I think few people would argue, is not irrational. But my point is that the food system can stay irrational longer than people can survive without food. So if we don't engage with the key players in the food system, and this includes the peasant farmer growing rice, but also Unity, if we don't engage with them, then we're just not going to get anywhere, and people can't survive without food. So this is essentially my conclusion. This is my final slide for you, is that I think we've got to embrace talking to people who we don't want to talk to and doing things we don't want to do. Otherwise, we're not going to make much progress. So that's my final line, and a final just thank you to various people on different projects that I've been working with closely to pull this together. So thank you very much.